Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship in one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship.
Jesus. Yes, Hosanna, Lord. We proclaim your name, Jesus. We make your name famous and great, Lord. You're so good. Amen. Praise you, Jesus. Well, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. And I've heard a tender whisper. of love in the dead of night, and you tell that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. Who we are, we're loved by you, and you're a good father. You're a good father. You're a good shepherd. You leave the 99 and you come after the one, Lord. You're a good shepherd. You're a good father. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some of the sonnets sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, Mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let your goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to you. Prone to wander,
prayer. It's a prayer for us to stay in his courts. And our hearts do wander sometimes, don't they? Wander after the things of this world, and God calls us back. He calls us back, amen? And I'm so grateful he calls us back. And he doesn't give up on us. He gave everything for us to complete the course, to finish it, and to get home. I'm on my way home. How about you? Amen? Hallelujah.
Upon the water, the great unknown.
The deep where you are, Lord, and where our feet may fail, but you're there to pick us up when we fall. Because when we seek after you, Lord, we find you, and our hearts are filled with joy and strength to carry on, Lord, to walk this course and to finish, Lord, this race. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Just worship him. Just worship Jesus. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever. A prayer. And my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever. When oceans rise,
my soul will rest in your embrace, 'cause I am yours, and you are mine.
Hallelujah. Thank you, God, that we're yours, that we belong to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, God, we just thank you for your presence, Lord. Strengthen us in the house of God today so that we can shine for you, Lord, this week. In your mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. You can be seated if you can. I understand if you just want to keep on worshiping. Amen. I feel you.
Hey,
I
brother.
Feel you.
Amen. I just want to keep on worshiping, brother. Amen. It is so good. God is so awesome. You know, you just kind of get caught up in the moment. You know, you get so excited. You know how you, if you've ever gone to a sport event, a football game, and, you know, and you get just caught up in the hype, you know, even if it ain't your team. You can get caught up in the hype. But we're all on the same team here. Amen. Team Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Woo. Boy, I tell you, I'm charged. I'm just ready to run up out of here, y'all. But not before we continue to have an awesome time in the Lord. Amen. It's just been so good. Welcome, Grace Community Church. We're so glad that all of you are with us today. Good to see everybody today. You look so good out there, too. You look so good. And to our online guests, we thank you for being with us today. We hope that you have had an awesome time as we've had here today. But it's nothing like being here and it just being connected with us. Come on and visit with us. Come on out and fill one of these seats and get what we're getting right here today. Amen. Amen. Well, we have some announcements for you this morning. Wednesday night gathering, come out. It's from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. From 6 to 7, we have a family meal, and it's always delicious. It's always good because we have good cooks here, and we love to what? Eat. We do. We love every opportunity. Amen. And from 7 to 8, we have our study time. So come and be a part of that. We learn, and we fellowship with each other, and we just get charged, just like we are right now. To leave here and go out into the world. When we leave out these doors, we're entering what? The mission field. To be the salt and the light to a dark and dying world. So come on and get charged. Come on and be a part of what we're doing here, what God is doing right here at Grace Community Church. And then we have our fire starters the first Monday. And this is something new that we're doing. It's the first Monday of every month. And it's with the servant's heart, need encouragement, you know, come on out. So anybody who is serving, who wants to serve, you know, just come on out so you can be charged. It's another opportunity to come on out and to be charged. And this is something new. I'm excited about it. You know, we got a lot of stuff going on here at Grace Community Church to be a small church, you know, but we're doing what God is allowing us to do, what we're trying to do, his agenda, what he gives to us to do, we want to do it. We want to say, well, just because we don't have this many people or that many people, we're doing what God has given us to do. And so you guys come on out and be a part of what we're doing here. I promise you that your lives will be fulfilled even the more, you know, and life happens to everybody. We know we have some issues, but when you're serving and pouring into others, God is pouring into you. You know, you're being charged. You're being charged. So come on and be a part of that. And right now, we're going to have a moment. Brother Sanders, come on up, and he's going to share with us honoring the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King. Amen. Yeah, this brother don't need any introduction, does he? All right, brother. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Honoring the dream of Dr. King. Dr. Ben, you got a lot of faith in me. Yeah, man. He called and asked me, he said, can you mind saying something about Dr. King? Take about 5 minutes and whatnot. I was like, yeah, okay. And where the faith comes in, that is, he asked an inner city Baptist middle-aged preacher to take 5 minutes. But Dr. that's 3 minutes right there. Dr. King is one of my favorite images. He's one of my favorite people that I like to talk about. And I like to see his work and his ministry as parallel with our triune God, Godhead. And when I think about that, in order to try to do this in a timely manner, I think about an hourglass. An hourglass is big at the top. It has a bottleneck in the middle, and it has a broad space in the bottom. But when I think about God, our Father, it's broad. And he is always consistent. His power, his love, his glory never changes. He always say what he means, and it's always going to be that way. And he covers the world. He covers every race, every age. He covers everybody. The world and the earth is the Lord's. And the animals, everything. And then as time progresses in this hourglass, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was born, and he came, and he sort of bottlenecked the glory of our God. He came and he showed us what God's love was about throughout the whole world for everybody. And then as time progressed, going through the hourglass, the Lord Jesus Christ gave a high five to our holy God, the Holy Spirit. And during that time, between that time, we see that the time of the day of Pentecost came, and the Holy Spirit landed on the hearts of every man, speaking every tongue. And spreading out throughout our nations and among people through man. Now, here is how I see Dr. King's ministry. Dr. King's ministry was about love, faith, his unity, and rights for everybody. He believed that everybody in the world deserved to be in the same place. Then his ministry sort of bottlenecked what the world rights, civil rights should have been. He kind of bottlenecked everything in his ministry by saying things that, sayings like only love can conquer hatred. Only light can conquer darkness. And he spoke to different people of different descent, using his strategies and his methodologies for a purpose. He had an assignment, and his assignment was civil rights, and his methodology was nonviolence. And what his message to the power structure at that time was, let's take one particular. He was in jail in Birmingham. And he wrote a flawless document around the rims of a newspaper. And his document was targeted the leaders, the white leaders in Alabama, the church leaders, the pastors, and he was saying that things are not right, and it's time for you to stand up and say something. Say something about the love that everybody deserves. Say something about equality that everybody deserves. Say something about the civil rights that everybody deserves. So this was the message of Dr. King. But then he said to us, the people who were he were fighting for, he said to you, he says, there's going to come a time where the opportunities are going to present themselves, and the challenges for you would be is to be ready to take advantage of the opportunities that's come. In other words, be prepared for when change come, because change is going to come. But then Dr. King was assassinated. His message still lives, just like the Holy Spirit still lives. Where does the Holy Spirit live? He lives in us. Touch your chest. Say this. He lives in me. But Dr. King's dream, his message still goes on. Honoring Dr. King, guess where that message live at? It lives with us. It lives with the middle-aged black man. It lives with the young black man. It lives with the older white man. It lives with the woman. It lives with the child. It lives with the Asian. It lives with the Palestinian. He says that if there's injustice anywhere, there's injustice everywhere. And Dr. King, all he wanted in his dream was to be, for us not to be judged by the color of our skin, but by the content of our character. That has nothing to do, has absolutely nothing to do with your bank account, has nothing to do with your age, has nothing to do with your gender. It has everything to do with your personal character. My charge to you is don't forget Dr. King's dream. Doesn't matter who you are, where you come from. It doesn't matter what your profession may be. You may be a parent, or you may be a doctor. You may be a Baptist preacher. You might be a violinist. It doesn't matter who you are. The message is the same, and you carry it with you. Where every time you go within your network of people, if you see it wrong, it's your responsibility to say something and make it right. Live a life worth living, honoring Dr. King. Thank you.
Thank you, brother. Amen. Thank you, Vince, for that good word. Y'all, Dr. King, I just want to say one thing. He was doing his work at a time a whole lot different than today. Now, I don't want to minimize or in any way disrespect the struggle that people have today, but they had it way worse back in that day. You see, it cost him his life, you know. So we want to never forget that we are part of that struggle, because it's Christ's struggle. It's the gospel. It's what God put us here on this earth to live out. And so we can't just let that slide. We can't ever take our eyes off of what he's talking about, what Dr. King preached and talked about, because it's what Christ talked about and preached about. So anyway, we're in our series, Building a Better 2023. And so what do you want different at the end of 2023? What do you want different about your life a year from now? You know, I got an email from a guy the other day that said that last year he made a New Year's resolution to lose 10 pounds, and at the end of last year he was 15 pounds behind his goal. But anyway, we need, some of y'all can't add very well. We need something more than resolutions, y'all. Resolutions won't bring a new life, y'all. We need the power that Jesus Christ gives and the life. He came to give us life, y'all, and life more abundantly, and a life lived for his glory. Yeah. Y'all ever go to the shopping, you go to the grocery store, and you get one of those shopping carts, and the thing just won't go right. You know, the wheels are messed up on it. And you try to push it around, and you got to go from one end of the store all the way to the other, and you got to wrestle with that thing. And the whole time, you want to go one way, and it wants to go another way. and you got to push it and mess with it. I thought I was the only one, but apparently not. But that's what my life feels like sometimes. You know, when I'm trying to go one way, and it just seems like things keep me going another way. But sometimes life, you know, it does feel like that. But anyway, I want us to look today at the Apostle Peter and his up and down life. I mean, he had an up and down influence with Jesus and an up and down time of going with Jesus. And along the way, you know, he made some major mistakes. But today we're going to look at Jesus had to straighten him out in front of the other disciples. But I mean, he went from one extreme to the other. And then after that, after what's happening today that we're going to look at, then 6 days later, Jesus takes him up on the mount and shows him his glory and pulls back the curtain and allows Peter to see Jesus in a limited view of his glory. And then not too long ago after that, Jesus starts telling his disciples that, you know, y'all are going to get scared. Every one of you are going to desert me tonight. Every one of you are going to fail me. And not only are you, and so you're going to, the shepherd's going to be, they're going to strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But Jesus was speaking to all of them, but Peter starts to straighten out Jesus, you know, and he says, you know, no Jesus, you know, you don't get me, apparently. You know, I'd never do what the rest of these jokers are going to do tonight. You know, I would never do that. You know, if all of them desert you, I never would. And so Peter had to be told, not only are you going to deny me, but you're going to deny me three times, is what Jesus said. And that's going to happen before tomorrow morning. But Jesus restores Peter later on in a painful experience at the Sea of Galilee. And then shortly after that, we see him preaching and 3,000 people get saved. So he had just like an up and down walk with Jesus. But let's pick up our story today, and it's going to be in Matthew 16, beginning in verse 13. It says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, and this is a place about 25 miles north of the Sea of Galilee. Most everything Jesus did was kind of around the Sea of Galilee. But he took him up here for a specific reason. And according to a very well-respected scholar, William Barclay says, confronting Jesus at this time was one pressing and demanding problem that would not go away. His time was short. His days on earth were numbered. The problem was there anyone who understood him? Was there anyone who recognized him for who he was? And that's when he asked him this question in verse 13, the rest of it. He says, well, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And this was the question. This was a significant question and a significant place to ask that question. This was in a especially pagan area. And if you look at this picture right here, this was that we were there recently, about a month ago, and this is a picture. This is where he took them. And this was a place with all kinds of different gods had been worshipped. This particular, go move on up to the next slide. This place was over 3,000 years old, these ruins are. But it's a place where they had multiple gods and multiple worship of all different kinds of just the most pagan worship you can think of. And this is an area where a lot of Jews and Gentiles alike were living together and living in this world with all those different gods. And Jesus brings them to that place to ask them, who do people say that I am? Say, against the backdrop of all of that. And so to remind them of the difference between the God of this book right here, the God of history, the Lord, the one true God who created heaven and earth and all that's in it, and as a against a backdrop of all that pagan, idolatrous, immoral, sick worship. And this is a this particular picture is the god Pan. And he was supposedly the god of all nature, and he was credited with being the source of the Jordan River, where you hear so much of it about. But in he asked them, he says, who do people say that the Son of Man is? See, what are people saying about me? And what Jesus wanted was, he wanted the disciples to say it. He wanted them to say it in order to teach them. In verse 16, 14, he asked, I mean, they answer, well, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets. People everywhere, you know, they were trying to figure out who Jesus was. His name was on the lips of everyone. Whenever, you know, he was out, crowds of thousands of people would flock to him in that area where there wasn't that much population. And out of what was there, thousands of people would show up and they would need healing. And most of the time he would heal all of them. And so he was out doing what nobody else had ever done. He looked like a human being. Everybody was trying to figure out, who is this? Who is this that's doing this? No one had ever done the things that he was doing. No one had taught the things that he was teaching. No one made the claims that he was making. But he claimed to be God, and then he did the things that only God can do. But it hadn't soaked in on everybody yet until the resurrection. That's when it really hit home of who he was. And then he asked the most important question that anybody can ever ask in verse 16:15. Then he asked him, but who do you say that I am? That's the most important question. It's not what's my career going to be. It's not where am I going to live or who am I going to marry. That is the most important question. Right there. Those are all very important questions, but they only have to do with the here and now. All right. But getting it right about who Jesus is, that's going to determine where we spend forever. And all those other questions may affect us for, you know, maybe 50 years or whatever, but that question and the answer to that question is going to affect you for 50 million years. Forever and ever. Who do you say? And it's written very pointedly, who do you say that I am? Individually, you've got to make that decision individually. You can't live on what your mother believed, or what your father believed, or what your wife believes. You know, I've talked to numerous people and asked them about their faith in Christ, and they'll say, well, my mama went to that church down there. My mama and my daddy gave money to that church. I was raised in that church. My wife goes down there. You know, but it's who do you say that I am? So that's what it's about. And Peter steps up and knocks it out of the park in the 16th verse. Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And as far as we know, Peter was the first one to ever answer that question correctly. As far as we know. He saw it before everybody else saw it. He grasped it. He said, Peter's saying, I know who you are. You're the one that our people have been waiting for 2,000 years. You're the fulfillment of all this Old Testament right here. You're the one that the prophets wrote about, the one that the prophets preached about. See, Peter believed it, and he was the first one to come to that place in his heart. You know, what Peter was saying is that Jesus didn't fit into any earthly categories. There just wasn't a spot for him. You know, you couldn't compare him to anybody else. He was in a category of one. That's who he was. Listen to what Napoleon Bonaparte was a a great student of just life and a tremendous politician and military leader, and he was fascinated with Jesus. I don't know if he ever became a believer. I kind of doubt it, but I'm not an authority on him or anything. But look what he said. He says, I know men, and I tell you, Jesus Christ was not a man. Amen. Now, we know he was fully man. But what Napoleon was saying, that, man, he's more than a man. He's not just a man. You know, Jesus, with the things that he taught us, he doesn't give us the option of being just another great teacher. You know, that he doesn't give us that. He claimed to be God. None of those other guys ever claimed that. He claimed to be God himself. But see, if you've made that personal discovery yourself, I'll tell you how rich you are. You know, nobody has so much money that they can't calculate how much it is. I mean, when you hear about these rich people, they're all worth a certain amount of money. We can't calculate how much we got. We don't. We've got more than we could ever quantify. It can't be measured with what we have. So Peter makes this great confession of faith, and here's what Jesus says. He said in verse 17, you are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You didn't learn this from a human being. So he says, you are blessed. You know what that word means? I mean, I looked it up in everything you can look it up for years now. That just wasn't recently. You know what that word means? Happy. That's what that word means. Happy. Truly happy is the person who's discovered that. But God's got to reveal it to you, y'all. You can't reason your way to it. You can't think your way to it. See, God has to shine his light in your heart, and you've got to respond to it. But he's the only source of true happiness. See, happiness is a person. As you get to know him, you discover the greatest happiness that you can ever get. Yeah, but people get mixed up on the difference between him and what they want him to do for them. See, he's not promised to do everything you want him to do. He loves you too much for that. I'm afraid too many of God's people are living, if I could just get blank, I'd be happy. If I could just get that job, that house, that girl, that guy, yeah, I could be happy. They're living for that. And what they don't realize is if they would just live for Jesus, all that other stuff would come their way. But I want you to now listen very carefully to something. What's the difference between thinking if I had $1 million, I could buy the stuff to make me happy? Now, see, it's not really the $1 million that you want. You want the stuff you can get with $1 million. So you don't want green pieces of paper. What's the difference in saying, I want Jesus, but I want him so he can do this stuff for me? What's the difference? Don't really want Jesus, but want what he can do for you. I don't think there's a lot of difference in that. But I can tell you one thing. Jesus ain't playing that game with you. He's not about that. He's about giving you so much more. He's about giving you exceedingly abundantly above all you could ask or think. And when we focus on anything else, we delay that exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or think. When we put anything in front of them and we live for other stuff, we delay that. Delay that happiness. Look at what John Piper, great preacher. I don't know if he's still alive, and I think he's still alive. He said, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. That's a good statement. Let's look at four lessons learned from an up and down disciple. You know, Jesus has just called Peter blessed and really commending him for his insight, for his confession of faith. And then in verse 21 through 25, let's look at these four lessons learned from Peter's, one of his fails. And let's read it together in Matthew 16, 21 through 25. From then on, Jesus began to tell his disciples plainly that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem and that he would suffer many terrible things at the hands of the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. He would be killed, but on the third day he would be raised from the dead. But look, Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Heaven forbid, Lord, this will never happen to you. Jesus turned to Peter and said, "Get away from me, Satan. You are a dangerous trap to me. You're seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's." And then Jesus said to his disciples, "If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross, and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you'll lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you'll save it." Let's listen to four lessons, and let's pray. Father, give us a hearing heart to your word. Lesson number one, he lost sight of the gospel. Yeah. That's what happened to Peter. He missed the most important thing. Yeah. It says Jesus from then on in verse 21, he says he began to teach him plainly that it was necessary to go to the cross to do all of that. Y'all, this is easily the most important event in the history of the world. There is nothing that comes close to this. Everything pales in comparison to what Jesus Christ was on his way to do. It's the focal point of all of history. You know, he made such a difference. It set a course for history. It changed the course of history. Oh, I wish you could read some of the things that just changed when Christianity entered the world in that Roman Empire, about, you know, the welfare of people and educating people and caring for sick people, all sorts of things that just instantly changed, began to change as his people moved out into the world. Yes. And you know, the liberal unbelievers, I guess they're God haters, I guess, you know. They want to change it from B.C. and A.D. to B.C.E. They want to change it to B.C.E. See, B.C. stands for before Christ. Everybody knows that. But they change it into B.C.E. If you read anything from the world now, it's going to say B.C.E. Because they want to change it and take the Christ out of there. But you know what? Still talking about the same thing. It's still talking about when that man was on this earth. And so Peter missed the most important thing that has ever happened in the history of the world. And I don't care if the world doesn't see it that way, if they're blinded by that. You know, people think sometimes, well, can't we just move away from the gospel? Can't we just kind of move on to other things? Absolutely not. No way, no how. You know, you can't move on from the gospel. You never take your eyes off of the gospel. You never forget that Jesus Christ paid for your sin and rose again to give you new life. You know what all cults and bad teaching and all that, you know what they have in common? They don't preach the gospel. That's what they have in common. But look, it says Jesus began to point it out plainly. In other words, he was just making it as plain as he could make it to them. You know, he's been telling them, he's told them these things, but it was kind of cryptic. He would tell them in bits and pieces as they were able to understand it and all. But this, he's making it plain. And then he's telling them that it was necessary. It had to be that way. There was no other way. Amen. Y'all, if Christ didn't go to the cross, all the human race would go to hell. Woo! Every human being who's ever lived would go to hell. That's exactly what was hanging in the balance. And on the third day be raised from the dead. See, this was the distinguishing mark of Jesus. You know, people say all the religions are the same. No founder of any religion ever claimed to have the power over life and death. Amen. None of them. And as we said, this put Jesus in a category of one. There's him and there's everybody else. He's the only person who ever showed up on this planet who had the power to lay down his life and take it back up. He said that was his ultimate sign. And Peter's going to straighten Jesus out. He missed it. It should remind us. It should remind us, every one of us, of just how quickly we can miss it. If we're honest, we're no better. I mean, I don't know if we've ever done that or not, but Alistair Begg, a great preacher I've been reading a lot lately, says our salvation without the resurrection, our salvation would be false, for we would still be living in sin. Death would prove, listen to this, death would prove to be stronger than God. Think about that one. Jesus' claims would be untrue. He would not be Lord. He would not be returning. He certainly wouldn't be coming back. And history would have no goal or purpose, and the human race would be going nowhere but hell.
Wow.
He had to complete that mission that he came to earth for. And Peter gets trying to get in the way of it. See, after Peter loses sight of the gospel, number two, you know, it's easy after this. He was easily deceived. See, when you lose sight of the gospel and say no to the gospel, you open up to all kinds of things. You know, or just lose sight of it. I don't think Peter was rejecting the gospel. He just lost sight of it. We set ourselves up to be easily deceived. And look, it says in verse 22, but Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Heaven forbid, Lord, this will never happen to you. And the word reprimand, it's a strong word in English, but it's real strong in Greek. Peter is getting up in his face. Really, getting up in his grill. You know, he's getting right up there where he shouldn't have been. And he quickly starts telling God what he ought to be doing. He's quickly starting to tell God how he ought to be running his universe. But y'all, when we move away from the death of Christ on the cross and his resurrection, we set ourselves up. And look what he says. This will never happen to you. And this is written in the strongest possible way you can say that. You might as well say that Peter was guaranteeing that that's not going to happen. And we get so caught up in the moment, in the emotions of that moment, and lose sight of what's really going on. He can't stop Jesus from doing anything he chooses to do, especially go to the cross. But Peter lost it for a little while. And he thinks he apparently, you know, by losing sight of that he's going to stop Jesus from fulfilling all those prophecies and all of that. I mean, it is really ridiculous what he did in just a moment of just losing it. Y'all, it only takes a moment for us to really make a bad decision that can affect us for a long time. But listen to this, y'all. The devil was using him and he had no clue. There are times of every one of us in this place have done the very same thing. Number three, He got rebuked by Jesus. Wow. Jesus turned to Peter and said, "Get away from me, Satan. You are a dangerous trap. You're seeing things from merely from a human point of view." He said, look, for Peter to be told, "Get away from me, devil." Man, that's a hard word to hear. But if you think about it, Peter was trying to get Jesus to do the same thing the devil was trying to get Jesus to do. The devil did not want Jesus to go to the cross. And Peter was joining up with him without realizing it, that he was trying to get Jesus to do to not go to the cross. And you know, we love talking about Jesus. Almost everybody loves to talk about Jesus. If you don't talk about the cross and why he had to shed his blood on the cross. If you want to make Jesus the nice guy, you know, that he came here to teach us a better way of life, the great. And if you want to make him all of that, you know, people will be okay with that. But when you start talking about the cross, and why the cross was necessary to reconcile us to a holy God who is love, but he's holy. And when you start talking about all of that, and, you know, then they get, you know, they kind of shy away from that. But he had to go to the cross to shed his innocent blood, and trying to have the good life of Jesus without the death of the and the cross, it doesn't happen. And fourthly, Jesus gave him another chance. See, he says in 24 and 25, then Jesus said to his disciples, if any of you wants to be my follower. See, he opened it up to Peter and to all of them there. He says, if any of you, amen. You know, he didn't exclude Peter. You know, you might think, you know, by blowing it that big, he could tell Peter, you know, Peter, I don't know if you're gonna make it as a disciple or not. Wow, you know, I don't think you fit this group here. I think it'd be better, Peter, if you can't get it together any better than that. I think it'd be better if you go on back to fishing. Really? Yeah, I mean, I would have fired him. Peter, go get your last paycheck. Pick up that pink slip on your way out. But Jesus didn't do that. You know, didn't exclude him. You know, he says, but he says, you must give up your own way. And you know, this shouldn't be thought of as something that, like, we get our lives in shape first, and then God accepts us. I don't think he's talking about that at all, you know, because it's not some kind of work that we do in order to become worthy of the gospel. It's a mindset. It's recognizing that he is the Lord of all. Recognizing that he has a right to now run your life. If he's going to lay down his life for you, shed his blood for you, now he's got a right to be Lord of all. If he's going to, you know, the Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know, it's if you're going to believe in Jesus Christ, that's who you're believing in. You're believing he's the Lord that has the right to run your life. Not just you add him to your life. And now, Jesus, you come go with me. No, you come go with him is what it's about. It's all by grace. But it's a gift, but it's not a gift to just do whatever you want to do with it. See, he wants to be your Lord. And in closing, I want to point us to a verse. I have no idea how long I preached. Anyway, I'm supposed to be watching that clock up there. This has to be shrunk down to a certain amount of time to get on the radio. So, Jason, you got a lot of work to do on this one. He's sitting back there, don't I know it? You know, see two or three minutes of me can turn into 2 hours, literally, for him to squeeze it in and take out all my and coughing and all of that. But especially 10 minutes of it or whatever it was. But look at this verse in Exodus 34:6. This is right around the time of God giving Moses the law. You know, we think of the God of the Old Testament being harsh. He never was. All the law was for protection, for a way to live for people that would set them apart from a very dangerous land they were going into, like those that pagan temple we looked at. See, that was all around there, and you could get sacrificed to one of their gods. They sacrificed their children. They would sure sacrifice you. And this was for their protection to stay as the people of God when he gave them the law. But look how God describes himself to Moses. Moses wanted more revelation of God. And so God gives him just a little glimpse of his glory. And then as God was revealing that, here's what he says, the Lord. And he wanted to make sure his name, the Lord, we've talked about it many times, the one true God, the God who is the sovereign Lord, who manages the whole universe and everything in it, and everything that's ever happened, ever will happen, it either has to be prescribed by him or allowed by him. But look what he says, compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. That's who God's always been. He didn't change. Jesus came to further reveal in a human being that we could see, something we could relate to embody God himself on this earth. He was fully God and yet lived fully human as well. But this is the God. This is the God. Compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Y'all, he so wants everybody to turn to his son. He says he's not willing for anybody to go to hell. But he'll do everything but make the choice for you. He won't do that for you. He made you in his image.
Thank you, Lord.
You're different than all the rest of his creation. You can choose. So what is your choice? Are you going to allow Jesus Christ to come into your life and take over your life? Oh, that's the only way it works, y'all. Trying to live with partly you in control and partly him in control, and I'll give you this much, but I won't give you that. It just frustrates us. That's all. And it frustrates the very blessings that God wants to give us. He's better to us than we are to ourselves, far better. But would you open your heart to him right now? For our friends online, if you're still listening, if you're still with us, would you open your heart right now? And just say, Lord Jesus, please come into my life. Lord Jesus, please come into my life and save me. If you just believe, if you'll just open the door, if you'll just trust him to do what he said he would do, that's all. You don't do anything to earn it or anything like that. You just receive it. Say yes to him. And we'd love to hear from you. Send us an email. Go to the website and click on Connect with the Church. You can send us an email and let us know. And we can call you and talk to you about that. And for any today, if y'all There are people all over the place in church that it suddenly dawns on them. This is what it's about. If you can just come to the front, let's talk about it afterwards. We're going to receive an offering in just a minute. And as they lead us in a song, that's a time for us to meditate and evaluate where we are with God.